My name is Jim Thomas, and I'm the director of the Center for Heart Valve Disease at Northwestern Medicine. I've been in practice for about 25 or 26 years. I've had a lot of experience in clinical aspects of echocardiography and doing research in it. Several things attracted me to the whole issue of valvular heart disease. You could take patients who were just as sick as they could possibly be and have a very good likelihood of returning them to a completely normal life with modern therapy. Well, there are several missions that we have at the Center for Heart Valve Disease. We, of course, want to deliver outstanding care to our patients. We also want to conduct cutting-edge research. We want to attract patients with serious heart valve disease from around the region, around the country, and around the world to come here for their evaluation and treatment. Surgically, we're doing several hundred complex heart valve operations annually there, and we're doing an increasing number of percutaneous interventions for treating severe aortic stenosis and mitral regurgitation in patients that really are just too sick to undergo open heart surgery.
My name is Lawrence Massal. I'm 52 years old. I live in the greater Chicago area. The symptoms that I had were that when I would exercise, and particularly when I'd go running along the lakefront, almost immediately, within about a minute or two of running, I would get lightheaded, then I would faint. I definitely had a feeling that something was not right and that it was a rather frightening experience.
There are several very common forms of valvular heart disease. Perhaps the most common that we see is aortic stenosis that can result either from a bicuspid aortic valve or from just old age and calcification.
I was diagnosed about 7 years ago with having a failing aortic valve. I had stenosis. That meant basically there was not sufficient blood flow through my bicuspid aortic valve.
The other types of valvular heart disease that we see involve mitral regurgitation, either from myxomatous degeneration with mitral valve prolapse and flail. And of course, then there are a host of other types of diseases involving the tricuspid valve, the pulmonic valve, and then complex combinations of all of the above.
Dr. McCarthy treated me with both respect and with a sympathetic understanding of the fears that I had related to the surgery, but he was also very candid. He presented the facts and presented the options. When I asked him the ultimate question, what would you do if you were in my situation, he didn't flinch as to what he would do, and it's turned out to be fantastically beneficial advice. I had the replacement of my bicuspid aortic valve with a valve that came from the pericardium of a cow's heart. My recovery was smooth. It was, you know, right within, I believe, 12 hours of the surgery. They had me up and walking. My strength began to come back. I experienced cardiac rehab, in which I saw major leaps and bounds with my strength. I was able to get back to work within a month. For 4 months, I was starting to jog slowly again. 9 months, I was back to playing pickup basketball and jogging on the lakefront again.
My usual advice to patients with valvular heart disease is to relax a little bit. Yes, you have a problem with your heart, but if you had to choose something to be wrong with your heart, you've made a pretty good choice. We can follow you along for a long period of time before you need anything done, and when that day comes, we have excellent options for you. I think we may do it a little better at Northwestern, but there are some excellent centers around the country.
I already recommend Northwestern and the Bloom Cardiovascular Center to anyone who has any sort of heart or heart-related issues that need to be resolved.